Finally. Now, to be honest with you, I didn't think this would ever happen. But we finally have Capture One on the iPad. And I just downloaded it, so let's see together if it was worth waiting this long. So today, Capture One has been made available as a closed beta version to a limited amount of users. And I've had a chat with a few in the beta testing group, and many of them seem to be Fujifilm photographers. Now, I suppose it has to do with the RAW file's sharpening capability, but we'll talk about sharpening in a moment. Now, myself, I'm a long-time user of Adobe Lightroom, and I think since its first launch in 2007, and I use almost all the Adobe apps in my work. I also use Capture One, mainly in the studio here or on location when I need to see straight away on my laptop what the camera is capturing. And one reason why I never switched all my photography work to Capture One was the lack of an iPad app that would allow me to quickly switch between desktop, laptop and iPad, depending on the situation. But this seems to be about to change, thanks to this app, and also thanks to the cloud service that should launch later in the year. Now, I've also seen some discussion around some tethering functionality as well, but nothing is confirmed yet. Anyway, let's not faff around and let's open Capture One for the iPad together. Now, of course, before we can start editing our photo, we need to import them into Capture One. And right now, this can be done in four ways. From the camera roll on the iPad, from iCloud, from a memory card, which you can read from either a dongle or straight from a compatible camera, and from an external drive connected to the iPad. Now, I have my dongle here, so let's connect this to the iPad and let's start importing the photos. And I have a few from my recent trip to Istanbul that I want to use for this test. So let's tap select all and have them imported. And you can see that when the photos are imported, they are organized by date. But of course you can organize your photos into separate albums as well. So let's create one now. I can click on the plus icon here and type the name, let's say Istanbul. And once the album is created, I can either long press on a photo to drag it into the album, or I can tap select up here and choose which ones I want to add. I can then tap to add to here at the bottom to select the album I want to add the pictures to. And now I'm ready to edit the photos. Now the first tool here in Capture One is the rating tool. And this is useful if you import an entire photo session, for example, and you want to quickly sort the images. You can apply stars and colors based on your criteria, but I'm going to skip that now because I have already imported a small selection. I might add a color later if I want to highlight photos that have already been exported and published, for example. Now, the second tool is for styles and presets. I've just opened the app, so there is nothing here other than the default that comes with Capture One. But you will see more content as soon as you start creating presets from your edit or import them. And these presets can be applied to more than one photo at the same time by selecting multiple photos and coming back here to select the style or preset. The next tool is crop and rotation. Now, this is where you can see that the app is very much still in a beta version state. The rotation doesn't show any grid to help you align precisely horizontally or vertically, so you have to eyeball it. And the crop as well is fairly limited, because you can only see one grid, which is the rule of thirds, but you don't have alternative grids, and you cannot set a custom ratio. For example, there is 16:9, but you can't set 16:10. But I suppose these will be added eventually. Now, this fourth tool is where the fun starts. I can finally make some adjustments. The options here seem pretty much self-explanatory, and particularly if you already use Capture One on desktop or Adobe Lightroom. So let's do some basic adjustments. I don't seem to have options to select a profile and change the Fujifilm film simulation for now, so I need to fix the white balance of the original capture and make some tweaks. And I can work on the overall exposure here, take it up a notch, maybe reduce the contrast. I can take down the whites and recover some details here in the shadows. And at any time, if you long press on the photo, you can see the before and after. Now, all these adjustments can be made with the Apple Pencil or with two hands, but you can also long press on the tool and slide up and down to change it. The color adjustments here are already quite powerful, as you would expect from Capture One. I can select one specific color from the photo with the color picker, and it's actually nice to be able to see the color as an outline. I can change the overall reds, oranges, yellows, etc. And here, for example, I can take the yellows down a bit. I can move the saturation and the lightness. And with these color changes, you can also create a preset to reapply the same edits to another photo. And actually, you can do it with pretty much any adjustment. You simply click here, create a preset, and you will find it in the styles and preset panel. But you can also copy the adjustments and apply them to another photo without creating a preset. You simply tap to the copy button down here, select the other photo, and then you tap paste. And the final tool is sharpening, where you can, of course, sharpen the image, but also apply noise reduction, film grain, etc. And interestingly, these options are updated already based on the camera you use to take the photo. And with a long time partnership between Capture One and Fujifilm, I can expect this to be on point. Now, not to say that you can't achieve optimal sharpening for Fujifilm with Adobe Lightroom. Oftentimes, the warmth effect you hate seeing in Lightroom is simply a matter of understanding how sharpening works and applying the correct values in the details panel. And I have a detailed article in my blog explaining everything, along with presets that will help you achieve the optimal result. And everything is, of course, linked in the description below. Actually, I should probably make a video about that too. As you can see, in this beta version, you only have options to apply adjustments to the overall photo. There are no selective adjustments, masks, or even delays we know from the desktop version. But I'm not going to complain. I mean, it's already great to see that the app has finally been released, so now it's mainly a matter of waiting to see how the development progresses. But one thing you can do here, though, is export the photo to keep editing on desktop and access the extra features. So if you tap the export button here, you can see options to export this image and share it to social media. And there's even an Instagram optimized option here that should come in handy. But if you choose the EIP format, the app will export the RAW file along with the edits you just made. And this can be exported to your iCloud folder, where you can then pick up the image from your other device. But more excitingly, you can make the whole album available through the Capture One Cloud, where you can then access this album from a different device. Now, at the moment of recording, and as I mentioned in the beginning, the cloud system is not available to test just yet, so I can't show it to you, but you can see it's expected. So this is the beta version of the Capture One iPad app. Finally. Now I'm traveling again, and I'm going to Barcelona next week to host a street photography workshop and meet with my friends from the Off Design conference. So I will put this app to the test more thoroughly. And we'll probably do a head-to-head comparison with Adobe Lightroom as well. So make sure you subscribe to the channel and you won't miss the next chapter. And if you need more editing videos, here's one for you. Bye!